Chandra, thank you very much for your time. It's a pleasure always to talk to you, but this is an on-camera interaction for the first time I'm doing with you.
Yeah.
As the first chairman of JIC on 1st of January 1999, sort of a revamped thing, and then later the first deputy NSA, how do you look back in these 20 years? How has the national security architecture, especially the NSCS, evolved?
First, let me say, Nikhil, it's a pleasure to have you here today and doing this interview. We had interacted, if you recall, during the Kargil Review Committee's meeting.
Yes, I came and deposed.
That's right. So, and one has known you since also. It's always a delight to meet with you and interact with you. Well, obviously, the NSCS has evolved considerably in these 20 years, I believe. It's evolved tremendously, mm-hmm. obviously, in these two decades. In a lighter vein, if you look at the where it is housed, when I came and took over the organization or created the organization, we were confined to about half a floor or one floor
of Sardar Patel
Bhavan. And the other day when I went to there for something,
yeah.
I noticed the entire building is there.
Is now with NSCS.
So that is one form of evolution.
Real estate has expanded.
No, and it's very neat and clean, which it wasn't when
right.
I took over. And one had a small role to play in ensuring that at least the official surroundings were conducive to the work we were supposed to do. But on a much more serious note,
sir,
it has been in this process of evolution ab initio.
Mm-hmm.
Because originally it was created out of the Joint Intelligence Committee. We were maybe half a dozen or 10 or 12 officers
mm-hmm.
who were there. And out of the structure of the JIC, the NSCS was created.
Right.
And there were many innovations and firsts, even in the initial years. I was there for around 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
And even in those initial years, there were new things that were done which never happened in government departments, most notably lateral entry from outside. We took in people from think tanks,
academia,
all over the place, wherever we found anyone good. And this process was developed. Also, as I was mentioning to you earlier, these were years in which a lot happened on the security front.
Right.
There was the Kargil conflict. There were the consequent task forces, which were, there was a Subramaniam Committee report,
yes, KRC,
Kargil
yes.
KRC report. Yes. And there were task forces. And in all this process, the NSCS was deeply involved. But structurally, you asked that question.
Right.
First, I think you need to look at what was the need for the National Security Council and the secretariat that was set up and the substructures and associated structures which go with it.
Mm-hmm.
What was the need? And the basic point for creating the NSC system,
yes,
if I may call it that, was that there was a very clear recognition that in the existing security architecture, there was a huge gap,
right.
A yawning gap.
Mm-hmm.
And that gap was that no one was looking 24/7 at security holistically.
Exactly. They were in silos, I guess.
They were working in silos.
Mm.
And also the concept of security was unclear.
Mm.
Even today, unfortunately, when one talks of security, very often people in India think of the armed forces, think of the paramilitaries, think of intelligence. If you are a little bit more evolved, you think of the foreign policy because that is linked to it,
right.
And sometimes the economy.
Mm.
But it is much more than that. There are a host of soft security issues which add and are a vital part
mm-hmm.
of a country's comprehensive power and therefore very important for national security. And here I look at things like health, pandemics, right, which go with it.
Migration.
Science and technology, yeah. Education. Mm. So here was an organization and system created to look 24/7 mm-hmm. at security in a total manner, and really everything becomes security.
Exactly.
So that is what we set out to do.
Right.
And over the years, the organization expanded mm-hmm. steadily. Mm-hmm. It is still in the process of expansion.
Correct.
But the thing that existed, at least during the time that I was there, which I think was a good thing, mm-hmm. was that there was a unified structure.
Right.
In the sense that the secretariat was headed by one officer, the secretary. Later on, he was also called the Deputy National Security Advisor. He also happened to be the chairman of the JIC. So that at one office, you got unified positions. And please don't think that it was a deadening experience. It wasn't. It was a very live, enjoyable period of learning for all of us.
And constantly evolving the situation.
Absolutely. And the point is that we had, of course, units and structures in the organization and officers with fairly clearly defined functions. Mm-hmm. But because our remit was so large, and because the remit was holistic, one encouraged officers to step out of their respective comfort zones and silos and participate in the broader activity of the organization. I can give you instances. We prepared papers on pandemics. We prepared papers on cybersecurity and even cyber warfare.
Right.
Umpteen number
I
of things.
I think it was on agriculture. I think
agriculture, energy, yeah. And the process was that whoever were the people responsible for a particular exercise or project, before it was finally approved, we had a discussion amongst all the officers,
right.
The senior officers.
Right.
And occasionally one got, when we put up the final paper or the final thought process, that you know this is against government policy, and our reaction was that doesn't matter.
Your job is to give a view, which is a considered view.
If you believe that is right,
right.
Please give it. And there were any number of occasions on which papers submitted by us to the government did express a contrary view to what was being done by the government or what was
the departments.
And it is the credit to the governments of the day that none of us got penalized and we still kept getting our salaries. So it was a live experience, but what you said is right. Mm. The silos were not there in the organization. The organization was, however, in the earlier years, till the time I was there, a unified entity.
Right. But whose idea? I mean, I just want to trace the origin of this idea. Mm. Whose idea was it and how did it come about? If you can give us some background.
Well, the background is that, look, this had been recognized for many years. That there was this basic shortcoming in our existing
security.
There was no one was looking at security holistically. What was happening was that there were ad hoc steps taken on security related issues rather than a total view on the entire gamut
spectrum,
of issues.
Yeah.
So this was recognized even as early as 1990, a National Security Council was actually set up, which did not function.
Okay.
Then by the time the BJP government under Mr. Vajpayee came to power in 1998, I think the Panth Committee was set up.
Right.
And that committee did recommend an NSC structure. And in fact, the 1990 structure and this 98 structure, which was recommended by the Panth Committee were different types of structures.
I see.
The former one didn't have an NSA.
Oh, okay.
The Panth Committee did have an NSA. However, what the Panth Committee suggested, which was in some ways very sound, but actually impractical, mm-hmm. it was a government within a government. It was a huge NSC
mm-hmm.
With a NSA with the rank of cabinet minister and three deputy NSAs with the rank of cabinet secretary.
Oh my God.
So it was a
parallel government.
Parallel government and a huge office. I mean, several Sardar Patel bhavans probably may
would
not
be
have
sufficient.
So the BJP government, you know, must have looked at this. They spoke to a lot of people about this and finally came up with what was a halfway house of creating a National Security Council system
mm-hmm.
with a purely advisory role. It was not a role that...
No executive role.
It was largely an advisory role. There were some executive functions
mm-hmm.
like intelligence coordination.
Sure.
Was
Chairman
JIC one exercised. So otherwise it was an advisory role. It also was interesting that the NSC, actually the composition was identical to the CCS.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a duplication in a way.
It's a duplication in a way, but there was thought even behind that, and here I will be totally candid about it mm-hmm. and undiplomatic.
Right.
Is that actually our the idea was that the NSC should meet from time to time. There was no, you know, period set, but maybe every 6 weeks, even every 2 months,
mm-hmm.
to let their hair down and brainstorm on issues
mm.
without the compulsion of having to come out with a decision necessarily at that point in time.
Which the CCS has to do.
Which the CCS does.
Right.
So the idea was a duplication, but to get this informal brainstorming going.
Yeah.
What I'm being candid about is that our political culture does in the present day and age doesn't have people with the capacity and the will to do that sort of thing. Maybe they are rushed off their feet, I don't know. But certainly this is not there, and during Mr. Vajpayee's time, I think the NSC perhaps met twice maximum. It was a little more under the Congress government for the first year when I was there, because around a year I was with them, or 8 months. Mr. Dixit had come with that mission, and he had come with the mission that I will have more NSC meetings, but not many more took place, at least in that first year.
Right.
I think two, maybe three.
Right.
Later on, I am told there were more, and I don't know what happens now.
Yeah.
But the short point is that the function was purely advisory.
Right.
Not that that advice was not taken.
Mm-hmm.
Very often that advice, not very often, sometimes that advice was taken. Mm-hmm. And I was mentioning cyber security. Mm-hmm. This developed not out of NSC, but NSC system. This was the NSCS, which
came
made
with
the recommendations, mm-hmm. and many of the things like certs, etc., that you are seeing are a product of that.
Correct.
Or the nuclear doctrine.
Yes.
Which originated both from NSCS and NSAB.
Right.
So many of the things that were put up actually saw the light of day in some form, maybe not immediately, but later.
Later.
Indus Waters.
Yes.
This was a study done by NSCS 20 years ago.
Right.
I mean,
correct.
MEA asked us to do it.
Yeah.
We did it, and then we pushed. We said now the waters of the Eastern River should not go to Pakistan.
Right.
And I was able to convince the NSAs of the time that we needed to work, and some preliminary work, they didn't take it to the logical conclusion.
Yeah.
But now these are all what's happening today
is
a product there. So basically, from my ears, and I can talk of my ears only with the authority, is that it was intellectually one of the most stimulating assignments that I have had.
Right.
That it was a great learning experience for one. And I think we did contribute. There were other areas of contribution which are relevant.
Mm-hmm.
The NSCS, initially people, you know, did not take it very seriously. But since the NSAs backed it, Mr. Brijesh Mishra and Mr. Dixit in my time, that everyone knew that this organization could not be
overlooked. Or not taken seriously.
Not taken. So they came to us, and in time they even began to appreciate it.
Mm.
Because we were an entity which was not involved in any turf war.
Right.
Though I was a foreign ministry man, but if there was an issue involving foreign ministry, defense, etc., etc., it's quite possible that our view may have gone with the defense ministry. We were looking at things on merit.
Yes.
So they recognized that here is a creature which is a very peculiar thing in the government of India. It has loyalty only to one entity, which is the nation, essentially.
Yeah, the nation, yeah, exactly.
And it is not worried that, you know, this is MEA or defense or, you know, you name it.
Yeah.
So they look to us, and occasionally they would say, why doesn't the NSCS take this on?
It would be like an arbiter's role in a way.
It was. Wherever there were more than four or five entities involved in the government, automatically the exercise landed into the lap of the NSCS, because then we would arrange these interministerial things and come out with our reports and suggestions. There were only suggestions. Occasionally also, you see, the NSC system in a sense catered to the NSA.
Exactly.
He was the driving force.
Yes.
And on some issues, the NSCS became the NSA secretariat.
Correct.
On issues that he felt, and on foreign policy, some foreign policy issues.
Right.
Because the NSA could not interact with his counterpart for some reasons due to scheduling. Then the deputy, the NSA, started the negotiations, even on issues with which we were not dealing with directly at that point in time.
Right.
So that became a negotiating thing, and increasingly, as other countries started adopting the NSC system, the secretariat became more and more active and valuable as an entity for the NSA.
So when you look back now, and if you look at the present, I mean, let's come a little bit to the present, because there is this school of thought, as you have, you are aware, that, you know, the NSA has now become all powerful and it's got a government within a government or a power center. How do you sort of react to that kind of school of thought?
You see, the NSA in terms of power will be what the NSA wants it to be.
Or the PM wants it.
Now, I cannot think of an NSA as powerful as Mr. Brijesh Mishra. Frankly.
Because he was also Principal Secretary.
He was Principal Secretary. He was very close to the Prime Minister. I mean, you know, everyone knows.
Yes.
So, I don't think the present NSA is half as powerful as Mr. Brijesh Mishra.
See, only a man of your experience can say that. Because now the view is that Mr. Doval is
I think being unfair to Mr. Doval.
Yeah.
He's a highly competent person.
Right.
And he's a very innovative person. Mm-hmm. And we both, he and I, have worked together with Mr. Brijesh Mishra.
Exactly.
Mr. Brijesh Mishra often spoke for the Prime Minister
because
he had his total confidence and he could speak to him as the Prime Minister.
Right.
I don't think Mr. Doval can do that.
I'm glad you clarified that, because you know, the thing that has been looked at, and as you said, other countries have started adopting this
same model,
and therefore I think he has a kind of coordination with a lot of these NSAs around India's periphery and elsewhere. Because this BIMSTEC, for instance, has started an NSA forum.
Yes.
So does it help that he is coordinating on foreign policy issues, on defense issues?
Look, the NSA, if he is worth his salt, would loom large on any government system in India,
right,
or anywhere else in the world. I mean, the NSA and USA were very powerful also.
Yes.
I mean, we dealt with Condoleezza Rice and her deputy,
right,
in fact. So the point is, the NSAs are enormously important.
Right.
They exercise all functions on security-related matters, and if security-related matters, by my definition, is everything.
Then he is the person.
I mean, I can tell you on the papers we did on pandemic,
right,
Mr. Dixit was the NSA, and I told him, I said, sir, this is a serious issue.
Mm.
I mean, if you have a swine flu pandemic, you will lose half your population.
Right.
So we need to have structures in India to address it. And here is a study we have done. And you please need to progress it. So he wrote to Sheila Dixit and all the rest, you know, in Delhi area, etc., that these are the things to be done. Health ministry, everyone was activated. So you would say NSA is trespassing. I mean, what has a health ministry got to do with this?
Security.
But it has. Everything has a security implication.
Right.
So you look at it similarly on energy. On energy, we prepared a paper on, you know, renewables. No one was looking at it.
And now, see, the renewables
you had Terry. We had commissioned a study from Terry in 1998, before I joined, in fact. JIC commissioned it on energy, and they spoke of only of hydrocarbon, primarily oil. And I threw back that study. I said, look, this is not right.
The future is renewables,
and this is how I think it should look like: nuclear, renewables, you know, the whole
mix.
So you can't look at oil. Oil is a problem.
Right.
But so, you know, everything. So the NSA will, I don't call it interfere, involve himself in anything. And the most ridiculous thing was on the Rafale issue, honestly.
Right.
It is the job of the NSA
to smoothen wrinkles.
Yes. It is the job, and you're talking of foreign policy.
Mm.
The next steps was negotiated by our NSA. Actually, I went for the negotiations to USA. It was a foreign policy. I had foreign policy people with him, and I'm sure Mr. Doval also, when he functions on foreign policy, doesn't do it out of the
blue. You did for what? Which?
This was during Brijesh Mishra's times with the, because Condoleezza Rice wasn't available. So his deputy, her deputy, and myself, we negotiated. We had two rounds of discussions in USA in 2003 or 4.
On which issue?
On next steps in for this strategic cooperation,
between US
which
and
led
India.
To the nuclear deal. I mean, we didn't have the nuclear deal in mind. No, I'm giving this as an example.
Yeah, exactly.
Because the NSA there are responsible for that.
Right.
The NSA here also has to be responsible. And what you said is very important.
Yeah.
That increasingly the NSA has become critical in many countries, and it is normal.
Right.
There is a logic, because with governance systems having become so wide and diffused, the top man needs some guy to hold it together. The NSA is the obvious.
That is how the thing happens. So now, just coming to the present, and one of the last couple of questions that I have for you is, when we look for the future, and the present and the future, it's got expanded, certainly, and in fact that chart that I was showing you, does this diffuse a little bit of the effectiveness, or does it improve the effectiveness of NSCS?
No, let me say
the expanded NSCS.
Yeah, let me say one or two things. One, an expansion is a good thing.
Okay.
Because I experienced in my time a shortage of manpower. And here I blame myself, not the NSAs, because the NSAs both, A, were very well disposed towards me, and we had excellent equations with both of them, with Mr. Dixit and Mr. Brijesh Mishra. And my sanctioned posts were more than I was filling. And in fact, my colleagues in the organization, and even from PMO, who were looking after, you know, the NSCS, they said, you know, you can take more people. And what I said to you earlier always weighed on me, that I want to develop an ethos in the organization first before I randomly expand. Because the organization must expand in a manner that takes care of its functions and ethos also. Because if you just expand blindly, it's not a very good idea.
So the culture doesn't develop.
Yeah, really. The culture was primary because I wanted to break down, you know, the silos. People do tend to work and do tend to hold back information from each other, which I think is a big sin.
Exactly.
You must share and work together.
So the expansion is good in that
sense. So expansion is a very good thing.
Right.
And I believe the budgets have improved. The building has become now the entire thing, I believe.
Yes.
But where I think if I were NSA, I would not function in that, would like to function in that way. I prefer the traditional style of Mr. Mishra or Mr. Dixit, which was that you have a unified structure in the NSCS.
Right.
Mr. Narayanan succeeded Mr. Dixit.
Yes.
And what he did was he changed the pattern. In fact, you had three or four secretaries in the NSCS, which too many cooks generally tend to spoil the broth.
Absolutely.
So that's what I feel is not a thing. However, having said that, the secretariat is a creature of the NSA.
Right.
What is the style of functioning of the NSA?
How does he assign?
How does he assign and how does he manage? Now, both Mr. Mishra and Mr. Dixit, since I know them, we belong to the same service, were great at total delegation. And they wanted to deal with one person
who would tell them.
Keep the organization united.
Right.
United, unified, they would only deal with me.
Yeah.
NSA, the present NSA, from what little I know of him, is a man of details.
Right.
And maybe he finds it more suited to a style to have specialists in each area.
Each of the.
So maybe it suits his style better. But for me, I don't.
You would have preferred the other.
I prefer the other type of structure, because A, it also avoids any possible infighting, which can always take place in organizations if they have several
parallel
and also it diminishes the role of each of those leaders. Because if you are in total control of an organization, your own knowledge and your own vision is very wide and you can direct the entire structure much more effectively.
Exactly.
So I believe this is not something that I would do.
You would do. But it is his, like you said, it's personality-driven. It's a personality-driven thing. So that's the way it is. And thank you very much for this lesson in history, I would say, contemporary history, because not too many people know the way you know the inner working of the NSCS and the government. And it's great pleasure talking to you as always.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.